Hello. Thank you for joining me for a brief look at the Byzantine Empire and a longer exploration of the growth of Islam and the ensuing empires it created. The last Western Roman emperor, Romulus Augustulus, was deposed by a German warrior chief, Odovacar, who took over as the king of Italy in 476 CE, cementing the fall of the Western Roman Empire. But as has been previously discussed, the eastern half of the Roman Empire survived the fall of the West, and in fact, it flourished for almost another millennia. We are now going to turn our attention to the Byzantine Empire. We will look at one specific emperor and how the empire functioned under his rule. Emperor Justinian. We'll be looking at Emperor Justinian. He ruled from 527 to 565 CE. He was the last real Roman emperor, the first Byzantine emperor. He was the last one to use Latin as the official language. Greek was the official language used in the Byzantine Empire after him. One of the things that he does is he creates the lasting government system that not only dominates the court and administration, but also the church and the provinces. He recognized that the ineffective, weak government was partially the cause of the fall of the Western Empire. So he moved to create a more effective government with officials and offices to create a civil service bureaucracy throughout the empire that was directly answerable to the emperor. He places these officials in every province and area in the empire to assert control over even the most far-flung region. The emperor had ultimate authority over most things. The people who served him, a lot of the people who served him at court were eunuchs. They held high positions at court. It was believed that a man who couldn't pass on wealth to children could be more loyal to the empire, which is why eunuchs were so popular during this particular time period. Eunuchs, as well as the civil service bureaucracy, engaged in very complex rituals and a formality at court. The word Byzantine actually becomes a byword for overly complex rituals. There was also a lot of bribery and corruption. These were huge issues in the court. And when access to the emperor was deemed so important that those who can control that access could really turn that power to their advantage, hence the corruption and bribery at court. One of the things that Justinian did manage to do, regardless of intrigues at his court, was he was able to create the Code of Justinian. He ordered the collection and organization of the civil laws and the laws of the nation that had been created during the entire Roman Republic and Roman Empire. And he codified these all into a single law code. So 900 years of legal tradition and customs since the 12 tables of Rome had been created. It took hundreds of lawyers to codify and organize all of these different laws. They created digests, which were writings of jurists about these laws. These were shorter commentaries on the laws written by those who understood them very well. They also created an index, which was a summary of all of the teachings contained within these laws. It became immediately influential in the East, and eventually it is rediscovered in the West in the 11th century and ends up having a huge impact on the laws in Western Europe during the medieval and early modern time periods. Justinian was also very concerned with imperial unity, and he wanted to regain direct control over the Western Empire as much as he could. So he tried reabsorbing the West under the Eastern Empire's control. So he tried reconquering the West. This was a very expensive endeavor. He's able to take back parts of Italy, parts of Spain, parts of North Africa. As you can see on the map, these are areas that he was able to kind of take back. And actually, at one point, he had taken back all of Italy. He created a new capital for Italy at Rev Ravenna, which is right here, very close to where Venice is today. He also created a representative in the West to represent himself, but they did not create an additional emperor. Eastern emperors would have nominal authority in the West. Some of the German tribes that were now functioning in the Western Empire would seek the emperor's support in things that they did and for appointing people to positions. The West becomes divided up amongst these Germanic tribes, and each settled down in kind of these former Roman lands. Of course, when the Roman Empire fell, it's not as if every single person living in the Roman Empire died. They all still lived there. They all still had jobs, farms, things that functioned. It was just the government structure at the top that failed. So when these Germanic tribes moved in, they just settled in these areas with other Romans or the other people living in those areas, and they just integrated. And so those German tribes kind of continued some of those Roman bureaucracy structures. And so being able to kind of link back up to the Eastern Emperor was not that big of a change for them. So one of the things, oops. Sorry about that. Sorry. One of the things that Justinian does to assert his authority, not just over the reconquered Western areas, but over the Eastern Empire, the Byzantine Empire, is he creates this idea of the divine imperial empire. How can a Christian empire still have a divine emperor? This was a question. Obviously, from the time of Augustus, our first emperor, there was this the cult of the emperor, right? Worshiping the emperor as a god, as part of that pantheon. But how do you settle that with the idea of a Christian monotheistic religion? So that's one of the things that Justinian kind of works towards. How did these Christian emperors reconcile those ideas of being a divine imperial ruler with also being a Christian? So one of the things that Justinian does is he rules that an emperor can't be a potential god anymore. Instead, they are a friend of God. They also have an exalted status, not just because they're the head of the empire, but also that contact point with heaven, sort of an equal to the apostles, if you will. So the idea that the emperor can act as a conduit to heaven and to God, as an avenue to heavenly approval. So not divine, but a BFF of God, if you will. So another thing that Justinian does that is actually quite controversial within his reign is he marries a woman named Theodora, and he decides to share ruling power with her. So they actually rule together as a couple, not just her as the wife of the emperor. One of the issues that made this so controversial, though, is that Theodora is not noble. Her family came. They were entertainers. They were circus folk, performers. They were thought of people who made money using their bodies. They used their bodies in entertainment, and so they were considered lesser in that sense. Her father was a bear trainer. And so kind of they were thought of as lowly people. Even the idea that they used their bodies in entertainment as a way of making money, people likened this to her coming from a family of whores, almost as if they used their bodies for money in that sense. So there's a lot of rumors about how Theodora had been a prostitute, but it's just a reference to the fact that her family came from circus folk. Okay. So her honor and integrity as empress were often questioned because of her background. With Theodora ruling at his side, Justinian recognized that he really needed to assert his control fully over not only the Eastern Empire and the bits of the Western Empire that he was able to reclaim, but also over the city of Constantinople itself. Obviously, Constantinople is the capital of the Byzantine Empire. It had been founded by Constantine. But the city is huge, it's massive, it has so many elements that go into it. And so Justinian needed to assert himself over the city itself. And by Justinian's time, it was quite a chaotic city. It was not fully under imperial control. And one of the things that was in incredibly popular within the city was chariot racing. So chariot racing was this huge deal. It was a passion of city officials and citizens alike. Races were held in the Hippodrome, which is a huge building. You can see on the slide here, this big oval building here. This was actually built by in Constantine's days. Chariot racing was this passion of the whole city. Races were held in that hippodrome. The city's population could actually be divided up amongst supporters of two different chariot racing teams. You had the blues and the greens. There was this huge rivalry between them, and it essentially divided the city, you know, in half between them. There were gangs that supported the teams, and sometimes it would even hold the city captive with riots and fights that they would have. There was lots of violence in the streets before, during, and after some of these chariot races. Justinian recognized that he, to take the city and fully have it under his control, he needed to subdue those chariot racing supporters. Think of soccer hooligans when you think of these chariot racers, kind of supporters. It's very similar in that sense. So in 534, a huge riot broke out in the Hippodrome over a race outcome. There were lots of arrests, but then the Greens and the Blues joined forces to break all of those who had been arrested out of jail, which is very unusual that they actually joined forces. This led to 9 straight days of violence in the city, just utter chaos within the city. Justinian used this 9 straight days of violence as an excuse to send in the army and impose martial law over the city. During this sort of chaotic time period, 30,000 people are killed over the course of these days. Justinian is able to sort of pacify the teams. He reclaims the capital from these sort of chariot gangs for the empire. We actually have a source that talks specifically about this situation. It's one of your primary sources by Procopius. Procopius was a court historian during Justinian's reign. He was employed by Justinian. He worked in the court. So obviously he paints Justinian in the best light possible. And he really writes him as a new Augustus in these official writings. He really glorified the achievements of Justinian. He also wrote the secret history, a real history of the Byzantine Empire, which is also very interesting. There's lots of gossipy accounts of the court's goings and things, some of that corruption and bribery we talked about earlier. Procopius describes Justinian exploiting the chariot violence as a way to take over the city. In the secret history, we see Justinian described as a despot, as a liar, as kind of an awful guy. Procopius describes Theodora, the empress. He describes her as like a sexual athlete, that she was, you know, very lurid, that she used her sex to gain favor with ambassadors and things like that. You know, there's no way to know if this secret history is true, but it's interesting that we have these two perspectives from the same person. It's a window into the court, kind of the backstabbing and duplicity that you can see at this high level of the court. So besides these Nicaea riots, these revolts that break out, Procopius tells us about other things. He tells us about some of the building projects that happened under Justinian. Justinian really wanted, much like Augustus Caesar or Octavian, our first emperor of the Western Empire, Justinian sees building as a way of glorifying not only the city, but himself in a sense as well. So he pours money into building efforts to remake the city as more imperial post these Nicaea chariot racing riots. One of the things that he builds is the Hagia Sophia, which in the slide you can see on the right-hand side what the Hagia Sophia would have looked like in Justinian's time. On the left, you can see what it looks like presently after it has been converted into an Islamic mosque. Very similar, but we have kind of the stylistic aspects that have been added since Justinian's time. So the Hagia Sophia was built by Justinian after the revolts. It became the gem of Byzantine architecture. There was a new use of arcs or arches and domes. There's a beautiful light effect in the interior. It was one of the largest churches of its day. This and it had this huge dome that just seemed to defy gravity. It's a monument to the church and to Justinian himself, God's BFF on earth. So part of what happens here is that it sort of became the face of the city. They're sort of changing that shift from the Western Empire to the Eastern Empire. And so this church is supposed to represent the height of the Eastern Empire, this Christian empire. The Christian church really becomes subordinate to the state a little bit, though, within the Byzantine Empire, that as Justinian is trying to assert himself over the city. We do also see sort of war with the East continuing with the Persian Sinazid Empire, which again is the same empire that our Western emperors were dealing with for years, where we had lots of issues when we were talking about those external crises that were affecting the 3rd century Roman empire. So the war with the Persian Empire, the main opponent is this Persian Empire in the east. Justinian really needs peace in the east so that he can focus on reconquering the Western Empire. And so in order to attain that peace, he actually pays a huge tribute to the Persian Empire to sort of shore up that side. Like, hey, I'm going to pay you a ton of money. Can you just not attack us for a while at least? And it does seem to work a little bit, but the Persians do start refocusing and regaining some control in sort of the Iraq, present day Iraq areas. In 604, the Persians started raiding that eastern border again. And by 614, the city of Jerusalem actually falls to the Persians. And so Justinian's tribune did not completely stop that attack. The Byzantines do fight back, and these border wars really start to drain the resources of both the Eastern Byzantine Empire and that Persian Empire. So this constant back and forth between the Persians and the Byzantines begins draining them, very similar to the Peloponnesian War and how it drained the resources of our Spartans and Athenians as well. This constant fighting back and forth is making each weaker, and it's starting to create a power vacuum in the regions kind of between them. And that region specifically is the Syrian region, which is really important with the next empire we're about to talk about. And so one thing I want you to kind of take away from this when we talk about the Byzantine Empire is that the Byzantine Empire is just one of the successors of the Roman Empire. We can kind of look at three different successors to that Roman Empire. You have obviously the Eastern Roman Empire. Byzantium is one of those successors, and the Germanic kingdoms that arise out of the remnants of the Western Empire as well. But our third successor are the Islamic kingdoms or caliphates that develop out of the eastern part of the Roman Empire. And so we're going to talk about the Islamic caliphates empire now. Okay. So first, we're going to have to start with sort of the region itself and what was there beforehand. So to understand the religion, excuse me here, to understand the religion that the Prophet Muhammad founded and the effects that this religion had on society, it is necessary to understand in part the ethnic, geographic, social, cultural, economic, and religious features of that environment in which the Prophet Muhammad lived. So we're going to talk about pre-Islamic Arabia first, and then we will move into Muhammad's world and Islam itself. So those two weakened superpowers that we talked about, the Byzantine Empire over here in pink, and the Persian Empire here in purple, they had a huge impact on the peoples of the Arabian Peninsula down here. Much of the fighting that happens between these two huge empires happened in these areas right here. And it caused a lot of disruption and turmoil to those people. And so during this time, there was a lot of Persian raiding on the caravan trade, on the cities that were in these areas as well. And it became a huge issue in these areas. They were greatly affected by the vacuum of power that kind of happened as a result of the infighting between the Persians and the Byzantine Empire. So let's talk about this land itself right now. So the geography and pre-Islamic culture of this area. So we're kind of talking about 1 million square miles, about a fifth of the United States, is what the Arabian Peninsula, this part right here, is. And with the exception of some oases and coastal areas, it is mostly desert and mountainous. It is a peninsula. There is the Red Sea is located right here. The Persian Gulf is right here. There are some water resources as well. It's quite an arid region dominated by a desert and mountainous areas on the coasts. Syria and other more green spaces are there, and we do have crops that grow in certain areas, including sugarcane, figs, olives, grapes. There are cotton fields in some areas. We see wheat, barley, flax, legumes, so beans, like lentils, chickpeas, and peas themselves that grow here. There's also orchards that grow fruits, vegetables, honey, things like that. Well, obviously there aren't orchards of honey, but those orchards support the bees that create honey in those areas. And so one of the things I want to look back here is if you look at sort of the trading routes that we have here. So the red are trading routes. For centuries, Arabia had long been a trading hub between the West and the East. Indigenous peoples in these areas thrived as spices and other goods from China and India traveled through these Arabian ports on the Red Sea coast into Egypt and Syria. The constant fighting between the Byzantine and Persian empires made trade in the northern areas very dangerous. So the profitable trade routes that were bringing new people into the southern Arabian area sort of became busier. One thing that I want to bring up as well is we do have a problem with pre-Islamic sources. So sources from the time period before Muhammad. And the growth of Islam. These communities were not necessarily literate. They had an oral tradition, and those communities relied on their history to be conveyed through oral communication. There was also a poetic tradition that would continue on the history of these nomadic tribes. But there was no real history of unity. We just have all of these different tribes. Also, after Islam dominates this area and kind of takes over, those pre-Islamic times were often regarded as a lesser time, as a dark age, if you will. And a lot of information is lost because there was a deliberate destruction of records from the time before Islam. It was kind of there's an Islamic term for it called the time of ignorance. Right here, I'm not going to try to pronounce it. You guys know I'm not super great at pronouncing things. But this idea of this time of ignorance meant that a lot of the sources that we did have, or even that oral tradition, those histories that we have from these pre-Islamic tribes are lost on purpose necessarily. So this time of ignorance, this jahiliya, time kind of meant that there was a deliberate destruction of information. So we don't know a lot, but what we do know, we'll talk about. So some of the things that we do know is that within society, 90% of the people worked. Okay. There was still hierarchy. There were still sort of your elites, right? And so that 90% of people that work can be divided up into three main groups. The And these three main groups are populated by Arab tribes. They speak Arabic, which is a Semitic language. And as I said before, there is no unified rule. It is politically chaotic. It is mostly tribal communities individually ruling throughout. They don't have a strong centralized state or authority. The large tribal units that dominate organization, they had blood ties, that they were connected by family. So let's talk about these communities. So we have one group of this main group are the settled peoples. These are the people who cultivate. They are the ones that live in the country or in small villages. Their houses are usually surrounded by gardens or orchards and enclosures for animal stock, for fowls, for chickens. They had shared grazing fields for livestock like sheep and goats. Their orchards produce bananas, dates, oranges, apples, plums, limes, lemons, sugarcane as well. We also had beyond the cultivators, you have the townspeople, you have the urban merchants, okay, that live in our larger cities. These people who live in the larger cities, there is a hierarchy, there is an aristocracy that ruled in these larger cities. We also have a mix of cultures and ethnicities and religions in these cities. You have Christians, you have Jews, you have Nestorians, you have Arians, which are a subset of Christianity. You have Arab pagans that live there as well. There's a lot of trade. Business is mostly based on trade. Again, if you think back to those trade routes, there's lots of trade that's happening. There are divisions of some of the cities and towns where there's an urban tradition along the Red Sea. There's trading with Roman and areas and other areas in Africa. There's a caravan network through the desert with the Persian Empire as well. So there's lots of connections. It's very cosmopolitan in these cities. Our two largest cities in the Arabian Peninsula are Mecca and Medina. They're important trading centers located on the Red Sea. These settled people, both the cultivators and the townspeople, carried out lives based on agriculture and trade. Although the peninsula is surrounded by seas on all three sides, fishing is really not practiced a ton. It's not a resource that we talk about much. So we don't have fisher folk as part of our settled peoples. Another one of our large populations within the Arabian Peninsula are our unsettled peoples. These are the Bedouins. The Bedouins are a nomadic people. They are local to Arabia. There are similar Bedouins in North Africa, but we refer to them as Berbers in North Africa. We refer to them as Turkomans in the eastern lands. But these Bedouins in Arabia, their identity is tied to their tribe. They are herdsmen. There are also battles between these tribes. They have laws and rules that establish tradition. They constitute a significant place in the pre-Islamic history of Central Arabia. The Bedouins, who were prevalent, did not involve themselves in the fields of art and craftsmanship, but generally made their living by means of animal husbandry, hunting, and trade. They also maintained the safety of the caravan routes and protected them from various attacks. The income obtained from caravan protection and services as guides for travelers and trade convoys passing through their lands constituted a significant income for these nomadic Bedouins. The Bedouins also considered their frequent attacks on neighboring cities and villages and on caravans as a means of living, as a normal means of profit. The trade routes that passed through the deserts from the earliest periods of history, excuse me, the trade routes had passed through these deserts since the earliest times of history. And as a result, the Bedouin Arabs became very skilled at attacking caravans and seizing their goods. In addition to stealing camels and food during these attacks, they also abducted children, women, and then demanded ransoms for their release. And it was all a part of their normal economy, this idea that they would sell their services to protect caravans, but then also the caravans that they weren't paid to protect, they would then attack as a normal form of profit. It's very interesting. So we have our unsettled peoples, our Bedouins, and we have our settled peoples, the cultivators and the townspeople. So these are the three main groups that make up our pre-Islamic era, Arabia. So let's, again, these are the trade routes, and you can kind of see the things that would be traded the most here. You can come back and look at these PowerPoints later if you'd like. Okay. So let's talk about religion in pre-Islamic religion. Although different faiths such as Judaism, Christianity, Zoroastrianism, and various other Eastern religions were common among the Arabs before Islam, the most common religious belief was no doubt a form of polytheism. So they were polytheistic, which meant they worshipped multiple gods. They had multiple gods associated with certain tribes. So depending on the tribe that you're in, you might worship one god over another. Or, you know, a certain pantheon of gods. There was differences in religious worship between tribes, between the nomadic Bedouins, and between the settled city dwellers, as well as our settled cultivators. So depending on what was most important to you, you might worship one god over another. We also had animist worshipers, which they worship spirits that live within certain inanimate objects. There was also a worship of tribal lineage, so a worship of ancestors. Mecca was the religious capital before Islam. Tribes would often bring statues of their gods to be placed in the Kaaba in Mecca. And you can see on the PowerPoint slide here, this is an image of the inside of the Kaaba. It's actually during a time when these images, these idols were being attacked and destroyed. You can see, you know, the fire, you can see the idols being broken and beaten. But this is one of the only images we have of the inside of the Kaaba. So I felt it was a good one to use. The Kaaba in Mecca was considered a sacred site. It was thought to have originally been a temple built by Abraham, whom the Arabs claimed descent from through his son Ishmael by Hagar. Jews descent from Isaac, Sarah and Abraham's son. And so we see two lineages coming down from this monotheistic tradition. There is a black stone contained within the Kaaba, and it is believed that it was brought down from heaven by angels and given to Abraham and Ishmael to place within the temple. So it's a very holy site and has been believed to be very holy for a long time. Violence and bloodshed were thought to pollute the ground and bring down punishment on those who transgressed. So it was considered a sacred, peaceful site also. At its height, there was probably over 300 different idols contained within the Kaaba. There was also, beyond this animus, beyond this polytheistic religious practices, there were settlements of Jews and Christians in these urban regions as well. There was a lot of common knowledge about these other ancient monotheistic religions, interactions with them through trade and urban dwelling. We can also see the influence from the Persian Empire, which brought some forms of Zoroastrianism into the region as well, and some of the gods that are from Zoroastrianism also. So that's sort of the ethnic, religious, and kind of cultural breakdown of pre-Islamic Arabian areas. So let's now turn to a discussion of the Prophet Muhammad and who he was before he had his revelations and how that progressed for him. So Muhammad was born in 570, and he died in 632. So he was born 5 years after Emperor Justinian died in Constantinople, to kind of put this into context of the Byzantine Empire. Muhammad was born in Mecca, into the most powerful ruling tribe there. They were the Quraysh. But he was born to a lesser branch of that tribe. So a powerful tribe, but the lesser branch. He was orphaned. Both of his parents died young. And he was raised by an uncle who was a merchant and a trader. He was raised as a traditional Meccan, and he behaved as one, like one, in terms of his religion, his practices, before he had his revelations. He was trained to be a merchant with his uncle. He was involved in the trade caravans. He came into contact with a lot of different people and faiths. Through his contact as a merchant and a trader, he became connected to a wealthy and well-connected businesswoman named Khadijah. Here, Khadijah. She hired Muhammad to run her trade and caravan business after her husband passed away. The two of them married in 595. She's actually 10 years his senior. They did have many children. Unfortunately, only one daughter, Fatima, survived into adulthood. It's only after Khadijah's death does Muhammad actually take multiple wives, which is a tradition for a man in his position at that point. He's highly regarded by his peers. He's trusted in a dispute over the Kaaba. Actually, he's trusted to mediate, to be an arbitrator, to arbitrate between a couple of different tribes within Mecca, because there was sort of concern over blood feuds over who should move the black stone in the Kaaba for traditional cleaning of the Kaaba. And so he acted as this mediator in this discussion. And you kind of see from this image up here, this is an image of him mediating. And you'll see I have all of the images of Muhammad kind of covered up. It is against traditional Islamic belief to convey or to put the image of Muhammad down. And so you will not see an image of his face on these slides, even though these are from chronicles, illuminated manuscripts that were written at similar times in the Middle Ages. I'm still going to cross them out just so you we not to be disrespectful. So that's why we have those circles over his faces. So anyways, moving on, in 595, Muhammad marries Khadijah. They have one child that survives into adulthood. In 610, so while he's married to Khadijah, he decided to retire from business, and he retires or he retreats in his retirement to the nearby mountain ranges. If you can see on this image here, this is an image of Mecca at the time of Muhammad, and it is surrounded by mountains. It is on the coastal region by the Red Sea, so it is quite mountainous. So he decides to retreat into the mountains for sort of meditation. And while he's in the mountain range, sort of seeking this life of prayer and contemplation, this is where he receives a series of religious visions. In these visions, the angel Gabriel, from Jewish and Christian traditions, he's also the angel that came to Mary and told her she was pregnant. The angel Gabriel comes to Muhammad and tells Muhammad the words of God, of Allah. And he tells him to recite. And the angel Gabriel gives Muhammad an oral account of this message, which he tells him to write down, to recite. And that oral message becomes the Quran. Muhammad wrote down the words of God that were recited to him by Gabriel. And this recitation becomes the Quran. And Quran means recitation. Gabriel was speaking to Muhammad about the proper worship of Allah, and he revealed himself to Muhammad using the Arabic language. Okay. Islam itself, as a word, means submission to Allah. So after he receives this multiple series of visions from 610 to 615, Muhammad returns home after the first vision. He's frightened, he's shaken by the experience, and he tells his wife Khadijah everything that happens or happened. And she becomes his first convert and his most ardent supporter in this. With her help, he starts to preach and convert others. His first converts will be some of the most important in the spread of Islam after Muhammad's death. Muhammad receives a series of visions after the first one, further revealing Allah's message. He starts preaching about a monotheistic God in a world full of polytheists. And so that's very difficult at first. This new monotheistic religion that he's preaching is in the tradition of Judaism and Christianity. It's somewhat familiar to these people, but it's a slow process. It has to proceed, and he has to proceed with caution. There's a lot of emphasis on this new focus away from tribal blood identity to a greater community that Muhammad is preaching, the community of the Ummah, of Muslims, and of Allah. He receives a lot of pushback from the ruling classes. And it's kind of a question as to why he received this pushback. And those who become his earlier converts sort of reveal a little bit of this. So those people who convert to Islam initially are a lot of the times the younger brothers and sons of merchants, people who had fallen out of the first ranks of their tribes and or had failed to attain the first rank, foreigners converted, a lot of the people within the tribal system that didn't have an assured place or were completely outside of it were his first converts. There is a stress on a return to traditional social values and away from the materialism that is growing in these cities. Muhammad also stresses a sort of social equality in a very clan, class-oriented society, this tribal society. It did not matter what clan you belonged to. What mattered is that everyone was a Muslim and they're all a part of the Ummah, the community of Muslims. So his first converts are those people who are being left out of the ruling ranks of the tribal system in Mecca. And so that's why you get this pushback from the ruling classes, is because he's converting those people that are being left out of the ruling class. Muhammad's uncle was eventually became a part of that ruling class of that ruling tribe in Mecca. And so Muhammad is protected for the most part while his uncle is part of this ruling area of the tribe. So while he's preaching this controversial new religion, he's protected. However, when his uncle and his wife pass away, both of them pass away in 619, Mecca becomes religiously and politically difficult for Muhammad. He's no longer protected by his own tribe. And without that security, he's fair game to attack. There's no law against killing a man who's not a part of a tribe. There's no social safety net without access to that tribe. And so we see one of the first big movements within Islam happen here. So in 622, Muhammad and his followers leave Mecca and travel to Medina. Now, this journey from Mecca to Medina becomes known as the Hijra. Right here, 622 Hijra. They leave Mecca to go to Medina. The reason they do that, this nearby city of Medina had a Jewish community that had reached out to Muhammad because he was well known as a mediator, right? Remember, the tribes in Mecca trusted him to arbitrate between the tribes about who was going to move the black stone in the Kaaba. So the Jewish community in Medina reached out to Muhammad as a mediator to help them negotiate between warring tribes within Medina, and they invited him and his followers to come to Medina. He was invited more as a political leader than as a religious leader. This trek to this trek from Mecca to Medina, the Hijra, becomes the beginning of the Islamic calendar. It becomes year one to the Christian calendar in 622. So there's 622 year difference between the Christian calendar and the Islamic calendar. So remember that. Remember how in the ancient Greek world, a lot of Greeks think back to the first Olympic Games as their year, the year that they used to base things off of. This is very similar. The Hijra represents that year one for Islamic followers. So this journey was viewed as a spiritual and literal journey, a break from one's tribe, the tribe of one's birth, and a commitment to a new ummah, a new community whose members are bound by faith and not by blood. Okay, so the ummah is very important. This community, this self-chosen community of Muslims, and you choose it over the blood ties of your tribe. In Medina, Muhammad was very successful as a political leader, as a judge, as a mediator, and as a religious leader. One of the important things that he does is he creates the Constitution of Medina, which is a treaty between the tribes of Medina, the Jewish tribes, the Muslim tribes under Muhammad, and the Arab tribes that all live there. This Constitution of Medina ended the tribal infighting that had ravaged Medina. And this constitution declared that the political order, it declared the political order within Medina between the tribes. It declared that everyone was equal in the eyes of Allah, that distinctions did not matter, that there was equality of believers, the ummah. In Medina, the people were more receptive to Islam, but the Jewish community was not as accepting as Muhammad had originally thought. Originally, the early converts to Islam had prayed facing Jerusalem, but when less Jews than Muhammad thought were going to started converting, he switched the position of the holy devotion to Mecca and away from Jerusalem. There was a holy vision that he had received that said, you know, to switch the position. So there wasn't as many Jewish converts, but there wasn't the embattlement there. You know, there wasn't a lot of the political pushback against them either. There was religious freedom. There was no forced conversions of the Jewish community, who were then considered people of the book because they worshipped the same monotheistic material within a book, which we'll come back to in a second. And the Jewish community was considered part of the ummah, the part of the community as well. But due to the financial situation of the migrants, the Islamic migrants from Mecca to Medina, and the fact that many of their possessions and lands had been seized by the Meccans, Muhammad and his followers did what nearly any other large group of people in Arabia would have done at this time and were currently doing. So they started leading armed groups of men on caravan raiding parties in order to continue to survive. Their money, their businesses, their goods had been seized by the Meccans. And so they needed to support themselves in Medina somehow. And so why not go on caravan raids? Good times, right? The Meccans did not like that their economically important caravan trade routes were being raided and were no longer safe for travel. Muhammad actually led at least 25 of these raids himself. But eventually, the Meccans launch a armed attack against Muhammad and his followers. And we have our first big battle between the Meccans and Muhammad's followers. It's called the Battle of Badr. And that happened in 624. Muhammad and his followers defeat a Meccan force three times their number. Later in 627, the Meccans actually lay siege to Medina. And this is where we see the use of trench warfare for the first time in the Near East. Muhammad and his followers are also able to defeat the Meccans in this siege of Medina in 627 also. And then later in 630, we see the conquest of Mecca itself. In 630, Muhammad and his followers took the city and most within it converted to Islam at that time. Muhammad destroyed all of the statues and idols within and around the Kaaba. He also performed the first Hajj, which is a pilgrimage to the Kaaba stone once he had purified it of the idols. And we'll talk about Hajj later. Muhammad led Muslim troops against the Byzantine Empire as well, around this exact same time. So we're even butting heads against that giant Byzantine Empire too. And so After taking Mecca, Muhammad was able to focus on the other tribes in the surrounding areas that were threatening his people and their religion and security in the area. But as news spread about his successes and the victories that he had in battle, Muhammad found that more tribes were willing to voluntarily convert to Islam than ones he had to kind of forcibly convert necessarily. So he ended up having more voluntary conversions to Islam than forced conversions. He also, to seal these conversions and deals, he would often marry the daughters of the tribal leaders to sort of seal those commitments. And one of these wives is Aisha. Aisha, she outlived Muhammad and played a very important political role after his death. Okay. So Muhammad dies on June 8th, 632. And Muhammad accomplished a great deal. From the time of his first religious visions in 610 to his death in 632, so the period of 22 years, he managed to found a new religion. He united most of Arabia for the first time ever, politically and religiously. He stabilized the trade routes, making it safer to trade and travel. He created a social welfare system within the Ummah. He created a centralized taxation system as well. And he created an ideology that transcended tribe, blood, genealogy. And this was the Ummah, the community of Muslims. So he accomplished a great deal in his lifetime. So let's talk a little bit more about the actual religious practices within Islam. And we'll start first with the Quran, so the resuscitation. So Muhammad was told to recite by Gabriel, and these resuscitations became the Quran. The Quran is made up of 114 surahs. These are the divine messages that Muhammad received from Gabriel. And then later, added to those 114 surahs is the hadiths. This is a collection of the traditions about what the prophet Muhammad said during his lifetime. And additional religious guidance that he provided and general advice about life that he gave out as well. So the Quran is made up of 114 surahs, which are the divine messages from Allah given from the angel Gabriel to Muhammad. And then added to that are the hadiths, which is essentially a collection of sayings of Muhammad about politics, life, religion, what to eat, what not to eat, things like this. So let's put the Quran and let's put Islam within its religious context. So there were three major times that God chose to reveal himself to the world, to the people of the book, according to Islam. The first time Allah chose to reveal himself, that was to the Hebrew tribes of the Jews. He revealed himself to them through the prophets Moses and Abraham, and he revealed himself to them in Hebrew, and the Torah was what was created from that. The second time was in Greek to the tribes of the Christians through Jesus, the son of Mary. Jesus is not seen as a divine figure within Islam, but he is considered a prophet, only a man, just like Muhammad. The Greek text that was revealed to the Christians was then written and made into the New Testament to go along with the Torah. The third time Allah revealed himself to the world was in Arabic to the tribes of the Arab people through Muhammad. And this is the final revelation. Muhammad is a prophet, and he is considered the seal of the prophets. That means the last in the line of the prophet, so the last revelation. And the revelation to him in Arabic becomes known as the Quran. This idea of the three major times that Allah revealed himself to the people is a subtle criticism to the other peoples of the books, the Jews and Christians. implying that they did not follow those rules that they were given to God in those previous revelations, which is why a third revelation was needed. So a subtle criticism to those previous revelations. So the Quran was written in Arabic. The Quran helped create Arabic as a written language and helped it spread. The Quran was not supposed to be translated, or at least the faithful were supposed to read the holy book in Arabic and not in translation. This emphasis on one language created a unity within Islam. Even after the common people learned to pray in their own tongues, Arabic continued to be the only language of the religiously educated, much the same way that Latin was in the West or Greek was in the East with the Byzantine Empire. An educated Muslim gentleman could go anywhere in the Muslim world, from Spain to India, and find people who spoke a common language and shared common faith. There was a stress on all Muslims being equal. Perversions of a caste system are wrong. This is why the importance is put on the ummah and the equality within the ummah. There's a large question of whether or not Islam is just for Arabs or if it is for everyone, and that becomes a greater issue within their religion itself later. The tone of the Quran is highly moralistic. It emphasizes ethics and proper behavior. We have multiple primary sources from the Quran that I'm hoping you guys read along with this, and so you can kind of see what we're talking about here. There's less theological emphasis, but there's much more about diet and charity towards the poor, how to perform various ceremonies, how Muslims are supposed to treat one another with justice and with mercy, so that there should be unity within the faith is very paramount within the Quran. There are concerns over idols and false attentions, so there can be no representation of people or animals, no attempt to create an imitation of Allah's creatures, which is, again, why images of Muhammad, like in this image here on the screen, has been blanked out just out of respect for these concerns within the Quran. The word, and because you don't see a lot of images like of people or animals within the Islamic world, the words themselves, the language, the font, the text becomes very decorative. So there's a calligraphy tradition that grows, and a lot of geometric designs are used when decorating books and walls itself. So let's talk about the major aspects of Islam. And these are the five pillars of Islam. There's an early notion of the pillars that show that a person is a good Muslim. And so if you adhere to these pillars, it's your way of showing that you're a good Muslim. There are no initiation rituals or sacraments like the mystery cults that kind of pervaded within Rome or within Christianity or Judaism. And there's also no early priesthood either. All are considered equal within the Islamic world. So our first of the five pillars of Islam is zakat, which is a charity tax. You are supposed to give 10% of your income to charity. And this doesn't necessarily have to be literally 10% of the money you make, you donate it to charity. It can be you offering a free meal to someone in your home. It could be you hosting a traveling scholar in your house. It can be doing things in the community and spending your money in positive ways. And so it varies on how that can be done. But zakat, a charity tax, again, this is an idea of a social safety network within the ummah as well. Our second pillar is Ramadan, which is actually currently happening right now, if you are my spring 2024 class. Ramadan is a month-long fast commemorating an early military victory for Muhammad. During daylight, you're not supposed to intake any food or water. At the end of the day, there is a huge feast that is to be held. This period of fasting is meant to be a time of atonement, and it is meant to be difficult to engage in daily activities because you are fasting from both food and water. However, it is stressed that this is only meant to be done by healthy people, that children and the elderly and those who are sick should not participate if they don't feel physically up to it. So there is caveats that are put in with this. Our third pillar is the Hajj, which is a once yearly pilgrimage to pray at the Kaaba in Mecca, or at least once in one's lifetime. This is to be done in commemoration of Muhammad's travel to the Kaaba after he and his followers retook Mecca in 630. So it's commemoration of that victory as well. And again, the Hajj is meant to be done only if one can financially and physically make this pilgrimage. Our fourth pillar is that of Salat, which is the prayer. And it is, you pray five times, five set times a day facing towards Mecca. And then there is the Shahada, which is the poetic statement of faith, which is something that you say during the Salat, the prayer five times a day. And that is, there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his prophet. So those are our five pillars of Islam. And by engaging in those, it shows that a person is a good Muslim. But also there is an understanding that if someone is not physically able to undertake some of the more stressful elements, it is okay under those circumstances. Hey, so what happens after Muhammad's death? Okay, so what came after Muhammad's death? Who leads the Ummah after him? Muhammad died without naming a successor. After his death in 632, his followers gathered and discussed amongst themselves who should assume the mantle of leadership. None of those followers, none of those men, claimed to be another prophet, only that they wanted to take on the political leadership of the faithful, but also technically be Muhammad's representative on earth. So no one was claiming to be a prophet, but someone needed to rule the political community, as well as the Ummah itself. So our first ruler after Muhammad is Muhammad's father-in-law, Abu Bakr. He was first chosen, but he died 2 years later, posing another question. So after him comes Umar, who rules from 634 to 644. And under Umar, he led the Islamic faithful to their most rapid and remarkable victories. After him came Uthman, who was a nobleman from Mecca, who was appointed from 644 to 656. Uthman was murdered in 656, and there were three different men who claimed the succession, including someone named Ali. Ali was a cousin to Muhammad, and like Uthman, he was one of the earliest converts to Islam when Muhammad first started preaching in Mecca. He was also married to Fatima, who was Muhammad's daughter by Khadija, one of Muhammad's only living children. And so after the death of, or the murder of Uthman, there was a civil war that ensued between the followers of Ali and the followers of Uthman's son, Umar. So we have a civil war that ensues, during which Ali manages to win a lot of adherents, but many enemies as well. And he was murdered in 661. So Umar, the son of Uthman, is victorious. But the followers of Ali went into hiding and continued to adhere to his son, Hussein, who is, again, because he is the son of Fatima and Ali is related to Muhammad. The distinction that is made today between the Islamic sects known as Sunnis and Shias stems from the problems which arose because Muhammad failed to name his own successor. There's a whole host of theological differences between Sunnis and Shias, but at the most basic level, Shias or Shiites believe that the descendants of Ali are the rightful heirs to Muhammad. Since Ali's descendants were in hiding, tracing a line of authority became problematic for those practicing Shias in Islam. The result was, over time, a variety of competing claims emerged, splitting within the ranks of the Shiites. The Sunnis believed, and the Sunnis are the majority of those practicing Islam, they believed that the rightfully guided caliphs, so the caliphs that ruled after Muhammad's death, so that would have been Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and then Umar again, another Umar, they were the legitimate heirs to Muhammad. So they were called the rightfully guided caliphs. Sunni means the way or the custom of the prophet, and it is a reference to the body of secondary literature, the hadith. And within that, it discusses many aspects of life not directly dealt with in the Quran. And succession problems, these succession problems did not hamper the spread of Islam in any way. At the time of Muhammad's death in 632, the Arabs ruled primarily the western and southern parts of the Arabian Peninsula. Under the leadership of the rightfully guided caliphs, in only a period of 50 years or so, they managed to establish an empire that stretched from India in the east to the Iberian Peninsula, Spain, and Portugal in the west. So let's look at that. So here is a map of what the Islamic Empire had spread to by 1091. Okay, and these are some important dates of significance for the spread. So let's talk about these a little bit. Okay, so the Arab Peninsula was under Muhammad's control by the late 620s. Okay, and at the time of Muhammad's death in 632, we have pretty much the majority of the southwestern part of the Arabian Peninsula. By 661, we have added Syria, Jerusalem, Egypt, the Persian and Mesopotamian areas. As Islam began to spread into Persia, and the Zoroastrianism faith that was there, there became kind of a stress on Persian traditions that went along with Islamic ideas as well. By 670 to 742, we see North Africa, the North African coast, taken away from the Byzantine Empire up here. We also see by 711 the Muslim troops in Spain, in Visigoth Spain. By 713, almost the whole peninsula was under their control. We will talk about this later, but there was a Battle of Tours in which the Muslims were defeated by Charlemagne's Franks in 732. We'll talk about that in a couple of weeks. We also see the Islamic Empire sending ambassadors to China. And this empire was to rival the Roman world at its height. And it took over large portions of the Roman and Persian empires as well. Okay, so let's talk about our individual caliphs and the caliphates, or rather the dynasties that each of these caliphs created. So our first one is the Umayyad dynasty. And this went from 661 to 750. And this was a time of great conquest and expansion in the Islamic world. It's based off of the third caliph, Uthman's family, the Umayyads, take over the caliphate and they become the first hereditary dynasty because Uthman's son, Umar, takes over after him after that civil war with Ali's and Ali's followers. They move the capital of Islam from Mecca to Damascus. Let me pull back a map here. Okay, so if you look at this map, Mecca is here. Okay, so right kind of in the heart of sort of that western, that coastline on the Red Sea. Damascus is all the way up here. Damascus is a former Roman province capital. So a very important site when it comes to trade from east to west. And this move from Mecca to Damascus cuts off Muhammad's remaining family members, Ali's supporters in Mecca from the apparatus of government. So it makes it harder for those other clans that are still hostile to the Umayyads to affect governmental policy. Damascus was an Eastern Roman city in Syria and far more centrally located within the Mediterranean world as well. The Umayyad caliphates built the Dome of the Rock and the Mosque of Damascus as well. Now, a mosque is a place of assembly and prayer and a place to study the holy writings of the Quran. Now, under them, we see a rapid expansion of the Islamic Empire, which we just discussed a little bit. But that rapid expansion creates certain problems for our caliphs. How to manage a multi-ethnic, multi-religious empire? What should the state do with non-Muslims? Conversion was pressured on other Arabs who were polytheistic, but non-Arabs in the area were mostly Jews and Christians. And these were considered people of the book, remember? People who had received those previous revelations from Allah. They were not pressed to convert, mostly because under the tax system set up by the Umayyads, these people of the book paid a special tax, the jizra, which made it financially smarter not to convert everyone to Islam. The profits that were made from these taxes were divided up and shared between the government and the Muslims, depending on how long they had converted. So there was a benefit to not convert everyone. The idea that non-Muslims under Muslim rule were forced to convert is largely wrong. Many willingly converted to Islam, either because they didn't want to pay the jizra or because being Muslim gave them access to better job positions in the imperial administration or economic advantages, just like those tribes initially converted to Islam. During Muhammad's time, it was just economically smarter to convert. Our next empire or caliphate to come out of this time period is the Abbasid caliphate. By the beginning of the 8th century, the Umayyad dynasty was starting to decline. It was being attacked politically by Shias, so the followers of Ali, but it was also being attacked internally by its own people, the Sunnis. They had begun to characterize the Umayyad caliphate as corrupt, as impious, as no longer providing the leadership that the Muslim world needed. So in 750, rebellion broke out. The descendants of Abbas, an uncle of Muhammad, managed to kill the Umayyad caliphate and most of his family. That's going to be important later. The Abbasids then set themselves up in Baghdad, which was a city planned and organized on the Tigris River. This move shifted the focus of the Islamic world eastward. Baghdad is only 50 miles from the old Persian Empire, old capital of the Persian Empire. So this shift to Baghdad also signaled a shift in cultural focus as well. The Abbasid Caliphate is often considered the golden age of the Islamic Empire because they presided over a great cultural renaissance, perhaps one of the greatest the world had ever known. The Abbasid time period represented a shift within the empire. It had previously been focused on Arabs, but the Abbasids included the newer non-Arab Muslims into the government, making the empire more of a community of Muslims, this Ummah, than it had ever been before. So not just this focus on Muslim Arabs, but Muslims in general. Caliph al-Mansur ruled from 754 to 775. He built palaces, mosques, gardens, religious schools, and public spaces. The government under the Abbasids was better centralized under this bureaucracy that included non-Arabs as well as non-Muslims. This class of educated secretaries and civil servants grew in size as Baghdad grew in importance and cultural standing. The Abbasids still had the entire empire to deal with, and they were able to use this new group of loyal civil servants to appoint as new governors to those distant provinces on a regular basis to ensure that no one was able to create a rival power base. So Baghdad was located in the middle of several important trading routes, and as such, the city and the people who lived there and the caliph grew very wealthy, allowing them to spend money on building projects, poetry, music, agriculture, and most importantly, education. The Abbasids created an institution called the Bat al-Hikmah, which is translated to be the House of Wisdom. It employed scholars from all over the world whose job it was to translate important texts into Arabic. It was largely thanks to these Abbasid scholars that we still have some of the most famous authors of in all of the Western intellectual tradition, Aristotle, Ptolemy, Eleusis. At the same time in Europe, many of these scholars' works were being lost and destroyed. All parts of society contributed to this cultural movement, either through commissioning translations, reading them, or hiring scholars as tutors, as putting up scholars in their homes as part of their charity tax. With this translation movement, scholars, Muslim scholars, started developing their own theories and contributions to algebra, science, medicine, geometry, literature. Think the Arabian Nights, and philosophy, to name only a few of the fields that benefited from Arabic scholarship. Al-Mansur's grandson, Caliph Harun al-Rashid, ruled from 786 to 809. He contributed this cultural movement and even reached out to his fellow ruler, Charlemagne, who we'll talk about in a bit, and sent him an elephant in a diplomatic gesture. He sponsored more translation movements and learning projects under his rule. He encouraged the sciences, medicine, and astrology. The Shia ruling group in Egypt was known as the Fatimids. The Fatimids developed as a religious sect of the Shia Islam in the northern African region of Algeria. So this is that group that went into hiding of Ali's followers. So they kind of started a rival caliphate to go against the Abbasids in Baghdad. The founder of the Fatimids, Abdullah al-Mahdi, was a descendant from Muhammad's daughter Fatima and her husband, Muhammad's cousin Ali. Mahdi started to preach and gather followers very quickly, and they started to attract the attention of powerful Berber leaders in the area. So those tribes, those nomadic tribes that are similar to our Bedouins in the Arabian Peninsula, they're called Berbers in North Africa. Together, these supporters of al-Mahdi were able to conquer North Africa. And finally, in 969, al-Mahdi was proclaimed the first Fatimid caliph. Not only was al-Mahdi the political caliph, but he was also the religious leader that the Shias had been waiting for. He was the imam, a religious leader, not just a political leader like the caliphs were, but he was a descendant from Muhammad and therefore able to interpret the Quran as well. Not just a representative, but descendant from Muhammad. While the Fatimids were solidifying their control in Egypt, the Muslims who had conquered Spain in 711 were experiencing their own renaissance. When the Abbasids had slaughtered the rest of the Umayyad dynasty in 750, they missed one male relative. And that male relative, who was a young teenager at the time, fled to Spain, where he continued to claim to be caliph at the capital of Cordoba around 755. So about 5 years after the massacre of his family, he's declaring himself caliph in Spain, okay? So this caliph under the exiled Umayyad family member spread further north into Spain, as you can see here on this map. He spreads further north into Spain and even pushes northward across the Pyrenees mountain ranges up here towards France. The Moorish conquest was stopped by a force of Franks, as I said before, against Charlemagne's troops at the Battle of Tours in 732. And much like the cultural and technical revolution that happened in Baghdad, Cordoba was home to a golden age. And known throughout Europe for its universities and learning, Christians, Jews, and Muslims generally lived in harmony and worked together to create a blooming society within Spain. It was the crown jewel of this world was the great mosque of Cordoba. It wasn't until the Reconquista under Ferdinand and Isabella of Castile in 1492 that the Muslims were completely removed from power in Spain. So from 711, when we start seeing this crossing over into Spain, until 1492, so almost 800 years, well, about 700 years, you see this Muslim power base in Spain. The Muslims left a linguistic and agricultural mark on Spain. There is a percentage of Spanish, a percentage of the Spanish language comes from Arabic. And there was a lot of information that came into Europe through Spain. So those translation movements that were happening in Baghdad traveled across North Africa into Spain and then eventually into Europe and was translated into Latin through that. So other things to discuss is that, in that time period from 800 to 1000, Islam reaches the height of its wealth and civilization under these caliphates. It became more economically advanced and scientific. And a lot of this wealth came from trade. It was really a center of global trade, as you can see from these trade routes right here. This is a map I've seen before. Arab traders became the dominant traders out of Cairo, out of Baghdad, out of Damascus. They traded from east to west, and really benefited greatly from their geographic location. Their rural and urban settlements benefit as well. Merchants are really kind of leading that. There's social mobility, and at some point, even 20% of the adult Arab males could read, which is a huge number in the ancient world at this point. The Quran was written in classical Arabic, which has more authority than anything else in the religion. There's no priestly class, and so more and more people are encouraged to read it and to know the Quran, and so that emphasis on reading the Quran itself really spreads the language and literacy throughout the Arabic world, which is really, really important. We also see an emphasis on ethical behavior, which is dictated by Sharia law, which is a type of law that dictates what to do about crime, how to dress, how to eat, hygiene, familial relations, and business. By 900 AD, there's a whole class of scholars and teachers that are out there to interpret the holy text and to interpret Sharia law. It's very similar to the theologians in Christianity and the rabbis in Judaism. There are a lot of debates and division on how scripture should be interpreted. It isn't a totally codified religion at this point. We even have segments that are breaking away from the main religions. You have a group of mystics that develop called Sufis. Sufi Muslims pursue a more devout personal relationship with Allah. They can kind of be compared to hermit monks within Christianity, or are the ascetics within the Jewish communities as well. They remove themselves from society. They remain celibate. They want to be close to Allah by doing that. There's a lot of intense meditation that happens within Sufism, a careful study of the Quran, intense rituals, snake charming is involved. It's found mostly in India and Africa today. There are missionizing groups that go out with them. They are devoted to public service and helping the common good. Within the greater Islamic world, there is a stress on learning and education. Again, there's no such thing as mass education at this point. Learning is limited to elite boys, but literacy itself is quite widespread. There's a lot of respect held for the educated, and there's a lot of respect held for classical Hellenistic culture as well. Islam, as it spread, took over those old Hellenistic kingdoms that came about from Alexander the Great's conquests, right? So there's a lot of survival of Greek learning from the 5th and 6th centuries. The Eastern Roman emperors, the Byzantine Empire, closed a lot of schools and exiled a lot of heretical Christians and pagans from their empire, forcing many of them to flee from sort of this religious persecution. And many of those scholars found welcoming arms within Baghdad and other centers of Islamic control. And these scholars formed schools in those empires, and they worked on translating texts from Greek and various other languages into Arabic, allowing that information to be read throughout the empire and spread in the Arabic language. There were classical philosophers that were translated with hopes that they could shed light on Islam. Through Spain, as I mentioned before, these translations came into Europe and then were translated into Latin. And this created a rediscovery of those classics. Arab scholars tried to find where old philosophy overlapped with Islam. This is very similar to the Neoplatonic movements that happened in medieval Christianity as well. One scholar I want to mention is Avicenna. He was around 1000 AD. He was an Arab scholar in Baghdad. He was a medical physician. He studied the ancient Greek and Roman doctors, and he compiled the first medical compilation from Greek and the Arab worlds, and it became the first medical reference book. And when it eventually becomes translated into Latin, it's used in Europe as a medical textbook for almost 1,000 years. Included within that are treatments for eye diseases, tuberculosis, an idea to develop a hospital system. And under Avicenna, he actually helped to open about 30 hospitals in the Arab world as well. We also have another scholar named Averroes, who lived about 1,000 or 100 years after Avicenna in around 1100. He was an Arab Muslim in Spain. He was a physician and a scholar. He worked for the Caliph of Spain, of Cordova. He had a very high status. He admired Aristotle greatly. Aristotle, particularly Aristotle, for his human reason and observation as a source of truth, how we know about things through observation of the natural world. Averroes wrote a lot of commentaries on Aristotle, and he translated a lot of Aristotle's works into Arabic. By 1200, these translations of Averroes are Averroes's of his Aristotle works made their way into Europe and were translated into Latin. And this helps contribute to that rediscovery of Aristotle that happens in Europe. This causes a lot of excitement in learned circles because Europe lost a lot of that learning with the fall of the Western Empire in 476, and kind of the invasion of those Germanic tribes. Christianity fell out of use. And the libraries that were written in Latin and held in those monks and monasteries kind of were forgotten about. Even the ability to read was forgotten about for a while. And so when these texts were reintroduced into Europe, you know, hundreds of years later, it was so very exciting for a lot of scholars in the Western world. Other things that our Arabic scholars contributed were maps and star charts. Arab merchants were using maps of the stars to guide them through their navigation of the seas, as well as through sub-Saharan Africa. And there was also ideas that they proposed that the sun was at the center of the universe. And this isn't something that Europe comes to accept, you know, until Copernicus, right? You know, they proposed these Arabs proposed the idea that the earth is at an axis, you know, and that the sun is the center, not the earth. They also contributed to mathematics, the idea that of the number zero itself, the numeric system that we use are based on Arabic numerals, developed by Arabic scholars. They also invented versions of algebra and decimal fractions and trigonometry and all the things I hate learning about, right? Math is not my strong suit. But so many amazing things came out of the Arabic learned circles and just their ability to take the learning and accept it and translate it, and the stress that they put on learning is it was just so amazing. And we really can't overstress it. But for now, we are going to leave the Islamic world. We're going to circle back to here in a few lectures when the Byzantine and the Islamic world start to push up against each other again, and the Byzantine Empire asks the Pope in Rome for help. This appeal for help is what's going to launch the Crusades to the Holy Lands, and we'll talk about all of those unintended consequences that arose because of those wars in a couple of weeks. So I'm going to leave you at that, but I appreciate you, staying with me and learning. So thank you very much.